Good morning. Welcome to the Kanawha City Church of Christ. We're so glad that each of you are here today. And for those worshiping online, we're glad you're able to join us, at least virtually. Look forward to everyone being able to get back together soon. I'd go ahead and ask you if it's convenient to stand and join me in singing a couple songs to start our worship service this morning.
Over all the earth, you reign on high, every mountain stream, every sunset sky. But my one request, Lord, my only aim, is that you reign in me again. Lord, reign in me, reign in your power over all my dreams. In my darkest hour, you are the Lord of all I am. So won't you reign in me again, over every thought, over every word. May my life reflect the beauty of my Lord, 'cause you mean more to me than any earthly thing. So won't you reign in me again, Lord, reign in me, reign in your power over all my dreams. In my darkest hour, you are the Lord of all I am. So won't you reign in me again, Lord, reign in me, reign in your power over all my dreams. In my darkest hour, you are the Lord of all I am. So won't you reign in me again. So won't you reign in me again. So won't you reign in me again. Dear Lord and Father of mankind, forgive our foolish ways. Reclothe us in our rightful mind, in purer lives thy service find, in deeper reverence praise. In simple trust like theirs who heard beside the Syrian sea, the gracious calling of the Lord led us like them without a word. Rise up and follow thee. Drop thy still dews of quietness till all our striving cease. Take from our souls the strain and stress, and let our ordered lives confess the beauty of thy peace. Amen.
Let's pray together. Father God, we thank you for this time of worship that you provided for us today. We thank you for our family that's gathered here. We thank you for the wisdom that you provide us through the scriptures and for the love and support and the system that you've set up for us through our body here to love and serve one another. And God, we just pray that that we can take what we learned this morning, apply it to our lives. Help us to reach out to everyone that we interact with in our daily lives, to be a bold example of Christ's love, and to ultimately bring others to him through our lives, through our actions, through the way that we treat each other. We pray that all that we do this morning is appropriate, and that we come before you humbly, willing to learn, willing to question ourselves, and to know that you provide all the ultimate direction and plan for us that allows us to have a hope of salvation and the confidence of salvation through your plan. It's in Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen. All right, we'll remain standing for one last song, and then we'll have a seat if it's convenient. I just can't lead this song. I can't sing the song unless I'm standing up, so.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Lord, we lift up your name with hearts full of praise. So be exalted, O Lord my God. Hosanna in the highest. Glory, glory, glory to the King of Kings. Glory, glory, glory to the King of Kings. Lord, we lift up your name with hearts full of praise. So be exalted, O Lord my God. Hosanna in the highest. Lord, we lift up your name with hearts full of praise. So be exalted, O Lord my God. Hosanna in the highest.
Amen. Please be seated. In just a few moments, we'll have the opportunity to partake of the Lord's Supper. And prior to doing so, we will sing, Worthy is the Lamb.
Thank you for the cross, Lord. Thank you for the price you paid. Bearing all my sin and shame, in love you came and gave amazing grace. Thank you for the love, Lord. Thank you for the nail-pierced hands. Wash me in your cleansing flow. Now all I know, your forgiveness and embrace. Worthy is the Lamb seated on the throne. Crown you now with many crowns. You reign victorious. High and lifted up, Jesus, Son of God, the darling of heaven, crucified. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Thank you for the cross, Lord. Thank you for the price you paid. Bearing all my sin and shame, in love you came and gave amazing grace. Thank you for the love, Lord. Thank you for the nail-pierced hands. Wash me in your cleansing flow. Now all I know, your forgiveness and embrace. Worthy is the Lamb seated on the throne. Crown you now with many crowns. You reign victorious, high and lifted up, Jesus, Son of God, the darling of heaven, crucified. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb.
If everyone has one of these, we'll go ahead and get them ready for communion. If you do not, please let one of us know so we can get you one. Today I want to start in Luke 8, verse 4 through 15, where Jesus talks about the parable of the sower. And it reads, "And when a great crowd was gathered, and people from town after town came to him, he said in a parable, 'A sower went out to sow his seed. As he sowed, some fell along the path and was trampled underfoot. And the birds of the air devoured it. And then some fell on the rock. And as it grew, it withered away because it had no moisture. And some fell among the thorns. And the thorns grew up with it and choked it. And some fell into good soil and grew and yielded 100-fold. As he said these things, he called out, he who has ears to hear, let him hear. And when his disciples asked him what this parable meant, he said, 'To you it has been given to know the secrets of the kingdom of God, but for others they are in parables, so that seeing they may not see, and hearing they may not understand.' Now the parable is this: the seed is the word of God. The ones along the path are those who have heard. Then the devil comes along and takes away the word from their heart, so that they may not believe and be saved. And the ones on the rock are those who, when they hear the word of God, well, hear the word, receive it with joy, but these have no root. They believe for a while, and in time of testing, fall away. And as for what fell among the thorns, they are those who hear, but as they go on their way, they are choked by the cares and riches of and pleasures of life, and their fruit does not mature. As for that in the good soil, they are those who, hearing the word, hold it fast in an honest and good heart and bear fruit with patience." As we take the bread, I want us to focus on the sacrifice that we have been blessed with. He has given his life so that we may live eternal life. And as we remember his body that was on that cross, I want us to focus on ourselves. Are we good soil? Are our hearts, is our faith the good soil, ready to bear good fruit with patience? Please bow with me. Lord, we are so thankful to come together again and gather. We just pray that we can fix our eyes on you, that we remember your body that was sacrificed so that we could live. We don't deserve it, Lord. Who are we to get such an amazing sacrifice? But we pray that we never forget, that we fix our eyes on you and focus on the body that was sacrificed so that we may live. Amen. So if you just peel that back part off, for those visiting with us, you'll see this, and we'll go ahead and take that. And before we take the drink the cup, which represents his blood, I want to dive right back into Luke here. As I've been convicted recently reading this and studying it and looking inward, and I want us to do the same today, look at ourselves and think about the soil that is in our hearts and how we're taking his word, that seed in our lives. And he talks about here the ones that fell on the path that were trampled. He talks about the ones that fell on the rock. We hear the word, receive it with joy. But these have no root. They believe for a while, but in the time of testing, fall away. I know I've been there myself, unfortunately, right? And then as for the ones that fell among the thorns, they are those who hear, but as they go on their way are choked by the cares and the riches and the pleasures of life. And their fruit does not mature. And when I heard that, I felt it. And I want to ask for everyone here, because I know I've asked myself this, what does my fruit look like? What does my faith bear? And today, as we focus on his blood, I want us to think about our faith. Are we putting his word in our good soil so that we can bear good fruit? And as he says, as for that, in the good soil, they are those who, hearing the word, hold it fast and in an honest and good heart and bear fruit with patience. So again, as we take the blood today, I want us to look inward, as I've been looking inward, and think about our faith and think about if we are really producing the fruit, because he has given us the most amazing gift we could ever get. He's already given it to us freely. So in our faith, in our love for him, are we producing good fruit? Please bow with me. Dear Lord, we're so thankful for the sacrifice, for the blood that you shed on that cross, Lord. Again, we do not deserve it. The sin in our lives puts us so far from you, but yet you reach out and pick us, and you grab us, and you pull us to you. Like a father to his children, you are a father, Lord, with open arms, even after the hardships and the trials, Lord. We pray that we can have that good soil in us, that we can take your word, that seed, and let it grow in us daily, that we can fix our eyes on your blood, on your sacrifice, that you have given us everything. We pray that we can focus on you and remember that. Again, as we take this blood, Lord, we pray that we can bear good fruit, that we can look inward and realize when we are our fruit is not maturing, that we remember that, yes, we bear fruit, but is that fruit maturing? And we pray that we can continue to fix our eyes on you. In your son's name we pray. Amen. Yep. And then for those visiting, we can go ahead and pop that second lid off there and get that. Before the kids go to their classes, I also want to talk about giving back. The Lord has blessed us with the fruit of our labor, right? And it is not mandatory by any means. It is not an obligation, but out of the goodness of what we reap, of what the Lord has blessed us with, it is good to be able to provide support, you know, for a congregation that focuses, that puts our Lord first. And that's really what we do here. It goes towards our youth ministry, goes towards our congregation, all the many things and outreach that we want to do and that we are doing. And so we'll go ahead and bow in prayer. Lord, again, we can't be thankful enough for what you've given us. And we pray that we don't lose sight of that. We pray that we can we can know the blessings come from you, Lord, that you have given us everything. And though it is not a necessity to give, Lord, we pray that we can give out of the goodness of our hearts, Lord. And for those that cannot, Lord, money is not the main need, Lord, but service. Our faith can be given to you, Lord. And so we pray now that we can have ourselves open our heart with an honest and good heart, that we can plant your word in good soil and give to you, Lord. Give back for the amazing gift you've given us. And it's in your son's name we pray. Amen.
Go ahead and invite our kids, ages 2 through the 5th grade, to make their way back. I think most of the kids I recognize know where they're going, but if not, just follow the kids in front of you. Prior to our sermon this morning, let's sing together Ancient Words.
Mm-hmm. Holy words, long preserved for our walk in this world. They resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Words of life, words of hope, give us strength, help us cope. In this world, where'er we roam, ancient words will guide us home. Ancient words, ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Holy words of our faith, handed down to this age, come to us through sacrifice. Oh, heed the faithful word of Christ. Holy words, long preserved for our walk in this world. They resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Ancient words, ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Ancient words, ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Ancient words, ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart.
Morning, church. So for the past several weeks, We have been looking at passages from the book of Luke as we've been reading through that together in our readings through the New Testament. And if it's all right with you, I'm going to have us move away from that for this morning, as I've got something that I'd like for us to talk about, something that, quite frankly, I don't normally do this, but I'm going to ask you to bear with me this morning. And for a change, I'm going to preach for me, and really only for me. And if you get something out of that, that's all right too. But this morning, kind of what I have to say is things that I really just need to say. And I pray that you will welcome me in that. So we're gonna move out of Luke for this morning, and we'll be looking at some other things. But before we even get into that, let's pray together. Holy Father, you are good. You're a good, good Father. You gave us your Son so that we could be with you. You gave us your Spirit so that we could live for you. And Father, as we bow before you this morning, we lift our hearts and our souls to you, knowing that you are the one who's in control. And Father, we pray that you will give us peace, that you will give us comfort in this world, knowing that you are in control, even in the darkness. So Father, hear our prayer. Lift our spirits and give us hope. We love you so much, Father. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Yeah, I think I've shared this with you all before, but I remember very vividly my earliest encounter with having to deal with death. It was April 4th, 1998, and it was the death of my great-grandmother, my Mama Clark. I was 10 years old at the time. And I remember even then the sadness and the anger. Yeah, I remember, I had one of those little rocks that you can get like at a souvenir shop when you go somewhere, and it has, it looks really neat. And I remember having one of those. And as I'd go to bed at night, oftentimes I'd look at that rock. For whatever reason, it fascinated me. And I remember, after Mom and Dad told us that Mama had passed, I remember going outside and taking that rock and just throwing it as hard as I could down over the hill, trying to hit a tree to see if I could break it, because for whatever reason, it's what made sense to me. Because quite frankly, I didn't know what to do about death. I remember when I was 14 years old, and learning of the passing of one of my best friends. His name was Ryan Kiefer, July 17th, 2002. It was the middle of church camp week, and I remember having to go home to attend his funeral. And I remember then not knowing what to do about it. I remember a few years ago, on February 4th, 2017, the death of my mother. And once again, the pain and the sadness and the anger, and not knowing, what do we do about this? Tuesday night of this past week, I had a very good friend of mine pass away in a very tragic manner. And he was only 36 years old. And once again, I find myself experiencing not just the sadness, but that helplessness and that anger. What do we do about death? How do we deal with those emotions? I preach about this morning because death is a very real part of this life. And as Christians, we're not immune to it. As Christians, we have to face it and we have to deal with it. And we don't always know what to do about it. In times like these, we often lean on Psalms like Psalm 23. We read, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want," and how he makes me to lie down in green pastures, But this past week, I find myself leaning on other psalms and crying out the words of these other psalms. Lord, do not rebuke me in your anger or discipline me in your wrath. Have mercy on me, Lord, for I am faint. Heal me, Lord, for my bones are in agony. My soul is in deep anguish. How long, Lord? How long? That's Psalm 6, verses 1 through 3. Or Psalm 10, why, O Lord, do you stand so far away? Why do you hide yourself in times of trouble? How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I take counsel in my soul and have sorrow in my heart all the day? How long shall my enemy be exalted over me? I cry aloud to God, and he will hear me. In the day of my trouble, I seek the Lord. In the night, my hand is stretched out without wearying. My soul refuses to be comforted. When I remember God, I moan. When I meditate, my spirit faints. You hold my eyelids open. I am so troubled that I cannot speak. I consider the days of old, the years long ago. I said, let me remember my song in the night. Let me meditate in my heart. Then my spirit made a diligent search. Will the Lord spurn forever and never again be favorable? Has his steadfast love forever ceased? Are his promises at an end for all time? Has God forgotten to be gracious? Has he in his anger shut up his compassion? Hear my prayer, O Lord. Let my cry come to you. Do not hide your face from me in the day of my distress. Incline your ear to me. Answer me speedily when I call. Can we just take a moment and be honest? We have all faced times of difficulty. We've all faced times of immense pain. We've all faced the reality of death, and sometimes we're faced with this reality of death or pain or suffering in the world. And you know what? Psalm 23 just doesn't seem to cut it. We know that the Lord is my shepherd, but sometimes we feel like we're out here as sheep and all we see are wolves. And we know that, Lord, you are my shepherd, but we wonder, where are you, Lord? Why aren't you leading like we thought that you would? You see, sometimes crying out to God just makes sense. Sometimes lamenting makes sense. And it's something that is just so very biblical. You see, we have these psalms, and there's other psalms just like it. We refer to them as the lament psalms. We see lamenting taking place in other places throughout the Bible. We see it in Habakkuk. We have a whole book that's called Lamentations. And do you know what these lament psalms teach us? They teach us, they tell us, that we can be honest with God. They reveal to us that God's love is so deep and so wide, like we sing about in our VBS songs. That God's love is so deep and so wide that he can handle my anger. He can handle my questions. He can handle my doubts and my fears because his love is just that great. The lament psalms tell us that when we don't know what else to do, we can be brutally honest with God. And we can tell God exactly what we are feeling. And so we cry out to God, how long? Or where are you, God? Don't hide your face from me. Hear our prayer, God. Will you spurn us forever? We can be brutally honest with God and say, God, why don't you get up and do something? That's biblical. The psalmist writes in Psalm 44, "Awake! Why are you sleeping, O Lord? Rouse yourself. Do not reject us forever. Why do you hide your face? Why do you forget our affliction and oppression? For our soul is bowed down to the dust. Our belly clings to the ground. Rise up. Come to our help. Redeem us for the sake of your steadfast love." Or Psalm 74, "O God, why do you cast us off forever? Why does your anger smoke against the sheep of your pasture? Arise, O God, and defend your cause." You see, this is the role that lament plays in our lives. It is to be able to lament to God about death, about hurts, about pains, about struggles. It's about being able to cry out to God and be brutally honest with Him. But here's what we also learn about lament. Lament doesn't have to stay in lament. You see, the value of lament is to get it out. It's to let it go. It's to vent it out. It's to put it out, to see it for what it really is. We lament to God to let out the pain and to let out the anger, to get it out of our soul before God and let God's Spirit take control. To let God's Spirit take a hold of our pain and our anger and take care of it and work cleansing and work healing. It's to, you know, we know what this is like. It's like when you go to the doctor's office and you've got pain and they ask you to tell you, well, where is it? And so you show them where the pain is and they show you the chart that has the 10 faces on it, and they say, what level is your pain? Point to one of the faces. And this is what we're doing before God, is we're going before the great physician and we're saying, God, this is my pain and this is how bad it hurts. Now do something about it. We lament to let the great physician know exactly where it hurts and exactly how it hurts. Lamenting is also to be done not just privately, but the whole reason that I bring this before you this morning is because lamenting is to be done in community. You see, part of the value of lament is to lay our burdens before one another, to lay our burdens on one another so that they can help us carry them, so that they can work life into us. And in this community of believers, even in our worst pain, even in the shadow of death, we can look at the love that's shared within this community and be reminded of the goodness of God. To be reminded of the goodness of God in this world. You see, in the community of believers, we are able to experience the goodness of the love of God through the people of God, who will accept us and hear us in our pain and carry our burdens for us. And it's with the help of the great physician and the support of the community of believers that we become able to walk through the darkness, kicking and screaming and crying and doubting the whole way, and yet still experiencing the love of God and the love of family. We move forward to the New Testament, to one of the most well-known chapters in all the Bible. In Romans 8, Paul is talking about some of these very things. He recognizes the groanings of the world. He recognizes that we groan for that new world, that all of creation groans for that freedom of the new heaven and the new earth that were promised. Paul recognizes the bondage and the pain and the suffering and the oppression of the dying world that's in constant battle with this enemy of death. And so we groan. And all of creation groans because we want to break out. What we want is life. What we want is for the pain and for the suffering to be gone. We want death and all of its effects to be gone. We hate death because death is the enemy. And so we call out to God, we cry out to God for God to arise and defend his cause. There's a song by an artist named Andrew Peterson. It's called Come Back Soon. And in a sense, it's a song of lament. And in it, he sings, "We wake in the night, in the womb of the world. We beat our fists on the door. We cannot breathe in the sea that swirls. So we groan in this great darkness. Are we alone in this great darkness? If nature's red in tooth and claw, then it seems to me that she's an outlaw. Because every death is a question mark at the end of the book of a beating heart, and the answer is scrawled in the silent dark. On the dome of the sky and a billion stars, but we cannot read these angel tongues, and we cannot stare at the burning sun, and we cannot sing with these burning lungs. So we kick in the womb, and we beg to be born. Deliverance, deliverance, O Lord." In this song, the artist cries for the deliverance of God. The tragedies and the pains and death that this world experience causes him to cry out to God, "Come back soon." But I want you to listen to one line from this song. He says, "'Cause every death is a question mark." Every death is a question mark. You see, with the sin of Adam and Eve, pain and suffering entered into this world. It entered into this world because death entered into this world. At that time, death became the ultimate evil, the ultimate punishment. And ever since that day, mankind has been trying to figure out what to do about pain and about suffering. We've been trying to figure out, what do we do about death and everything that comes with it? What do we do about pain and evil and suffering? Every death is a question mark. But here's what we know. God has answered that question. Not the meaning of the individual pains and the individual sufferings. Not the meaning of a particular death, or even how to grieve and how to cope and live life in the light of these individual pains or sufferings or death. These are all things that we struggle with and things that we continue to struggle with. But the answer that God gives is the answer that Paul gives in Romans chapter 8. Paul talks about these struggles and these pains. He talks about the groaning of creation. And then he says in verse 35, "Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword?" Paul recognizes that these things are still a part of this world, no matter how much we don't want them to be. These are still a part of this world, and we're still going to have to deal with them. And then Paul moves forward, and after this, Paul quotes a psalm. And it's not just any psalm. He quotes a psalm of lament. He quotes from an earlier part of Psalm 44, which we read from earlier. And he says, "As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered." It's like he looks at God and he says, "You know what, God, we're just out here like sheep. And we're getting slaughtered out here, God. Or at least that's what it feels like. We're out here like sheep being slaughtered and there's no shepherd to be found." So where's the shepherd? We're dealing with wickedness and evil. We're dealing with pain and suffering. Sin and death are staining our world, and we feel at times like we're just getting slaughtered out here. But Paul says, no. Paul says, no, I know it feels that way. Paul says, I know what it is that you're dealing with right now. But let me help you see a little bit further down the line. Let me help you see what may be hidden from you in this darkness right now. Let me point you beyond your present situation. And let me point you to Jesus. And so Paul says, no. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. You see, we can and we will face some of the darkest times in our lives. And in those times, we can experience the doubts, and we can experience the pain, and we can experience the anger, and we can cry out to God and be brutally honest with God and say, God, why aren't you doing what I thought you would be doing? How long, God? Where are you, God? Why are you hiding from me? Will you ignore me forever? God, why don't you just wake up and do something? We can live in the pain and the darkness of this world that is stained by the enemy of sin and death and wonder why God isn't acting the way that we thought he would. But in the midst of all that, we ultimately come back to the story that renews us. We ultimately come back to the story that gives us life. The story that gives us hope. The story that gives us hope beyond the present darkness and gives us hope of a future light. The story that gives us hope of a future life without death and without pain and without injustices, without oppression, without suffering, without war, where God will wipe away every tear from our eye to a future of joy and peace. And the story that we come back to is the story that we will look at and we will celebrate next week, where we kneel at the cross and we marvel at the empty tomb. And we hear the voice of God that speaks down from the cross and speaks out from the empty tomb and says, no matter how dark and how evil and how shaky these days may seem, no matter what you may be experiencing, no matter how scary it might be, nothing can separate you from my love. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us and who continues to love us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height nor depth nor anything else in all of creation, no matter what Satan may throw at us, nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. And so we can cry out to God. And we can experience pain and we can experience hurt and we can be brutally honest with God, just like the psalmist teaches us that we can. And we can know that even in those moments, nothing can separate us from the love of God. And so we sing, even in the darkness and the hurt of our souls, we can sing about the peace of Christ. Peace that doesn't make sense in this world, but yet surpasses all understanding. And even when our very spirits, when our very souls hurt so much that we want to cry out to God, we can still sing, "It is well with my soul." Because nothing can separate us from the love of God. And so this morning, we're going to stand and we're going to sing together. And as we do that, the invitation is open to accept that love of God and realize that you can face this world, even in all the darkness and all the pain, and you can still cry out and know that nothing can separate you from that love. And you can experience that peace that surpasses all understanding. And even when our souls hurt to the very core, we can still know that it's well. So Chris is going to come lead us in a song. Let's stand together and sing. If you need to respond, I'll be up front here to receive you.
Thank you.